As much fun as it's been to cast my gaze towards newer point-and-click titles, there's something missing, a certain feeling that newer games, even the low-res budget-eye ones, don't quite capture. I could do something else, more old-school, almost a throwback to yesteryear where plots were simpler but equally epic in scale. Oh, that was lucky. Order of the Thorne fell out of Infamous Quest, an independent studio, whatever the hell that means nowadays, who previously brought us Quest for Infamy. I haven't played that one myself, but its touted RPG elements and free character classes will probably put Quest for Glory in your mind hole. And given that sequels are in development for both Quiffy and Ood, I'm led to believe they've had something of a smattering of success between the two. Let's dig in and see what the fuss is. So, is there any better way to open your fantasy adventure game than with an Albert Einstein quote? Maybe. This way seems pretty good though. On to the actual story, which opens with a text crawl telling us of a group of knights known as the Order of the Thorne, who existed, that's about as much as we're given. Then it throws down an opening theme which I can only describe as a bastard child of an 80s fantasy film theme and three more 80s fantasy film themes formed in a glorious foursome that's really hard to illustrate. I don't know which 80s fantasy film theme I'm talking about here, but I'm sure it's the one you have in your head right now. From here we're introduced to a young bard, barding it up in the centre of town when
I'm just standing in the town square, baby.
And when he starts to chat with a passing monk.
Finn. I'm Finn the Bard.
Okay, hold on now, that might sound like a daft name, but considering you need to be a human half-elf fighter with a minimum of 15 strength, wisdom, dex, charisma, 12 for int and 10 for con, reach at least 5th level before switching over to thief, then having to reach at least 9th level to become a bard in the first place, there ain't gonna be that many about. You can call yourself whatever you want. At least if you're going by 1st edition rules. I don't know, I've only played 2.25 games of 3rd edition. Anyway, back to this monk. Turns out he knew your old da, a fellow bard, friend of the aforementioned Order of the Thorne with whom he fought in a big old war and who turns out to be the impetus behind Finn's current endeavour. He seeks adventure for purposes of having material to sing about and thus he's off to the Fairy Kingdom to participate in the King's Challenge. It's a challenge set by the King of the Fairy Kingdom, unbelievably. The winner gets one wish that's within the King's power to grant and gains the title Champion of the Fairy Kingdom. If I'm honest, I'd be putting that on my CV straight away. The challenge this time round is to find the Queen, who is hidden somewhere within the kingdom. Not in a storm the castle kind of way, more of an adults playing hide and seek kind of way. Hell, it's made to sound like it was her idea. You and your fellow participants set off to find the Queen and win the glory, except this guy who gives up immediately. Apart from the 80s-est of all the 80s intros, the plot is what first clued me in about the game's old school influences. It's rare these days to have such a simple premise set up right from the start. Find the Queen, win the challenge. And, mild spoiler, it doesn't get much more complicated as you wander the lands helping out the fairy folk and taking watermelon from human picnickers. What do you mean that isn't a real word? But nonetheless, that's the plot right from the start, winning the King's Challenge. Other games, even ones made in the same adventure game studio engine that Order of the Thorne uses, will generally start as just another day or some smaller plot, which unravels into a larger plot like shoelaces made of betrayal and one-liners, that one got away from me. The most obvious influences appear to be Sierra's old quest titles, like the large grid-like world map reminiscent of older King's Quest games, or the booming narrator found in Space Quests 4 and 6.
Even though it looks like the tree has a face, it can't talk to you.
The narrator they've got here isn't exactly the late Gary Owens, but then again, who is? Tough act to follow, that fella. One major departure from these old games, however, is that you're not going to be put in a situation where you can't win, either by severed plot threads or coming down with a nasty case of eaten by alligators. The game outright states that it won't try to kill you in half at every opportunity. Rampant murder death is something I feel the genre can safely leave behind, and considering how much there is to explore and how many people you need to talk to, it was welcome. The size of the world means you need to seek out puzzles to solve as well as the usual obligatory solving, which must be the adventure part of point-and-click adventure that I've heard so much about. You can't say explore everything then slaughter the player for heading the wrong way, it wouldn't work. So explore everything you do, with a modern standard of two-button interface. Left-click to do, right-click to look. Move the mouse to the top of the screen to make your inventory bounce into frame. That's also where your loot is hiding. I mean, bard got a bard, what do you expect? You start off with a few songs to play, learn more as you go, and can play them at pretty much any time, which is done via this wee screen here. The influence I wanted to cite here was the distaff from Loom, but I'm not even sure that's right. Whereas Loom had a single line of notes, which you didn't even have full access to until later in the game, Ood gives you 4 strings with 4 frets for your plucking pleasure. It can get a bit annoying when you need to pick a song and play follow the leader every single time, but you can turn the loop from hard to easy mode and play songs automatically rather than deal with all that maniacal clicking. It's essentially an extra inventory item with a little bit more complexity. Other examples would be the notebook in Discworld Noir or the smartphone in the later Blackwell games. In the wrong hands, this sort of mechanic can feel exactly like it's the extra inventory item that it really is, rather than a complex item or a special ability. Happily, Order of the Thorne does it right. You do actually feel like you're an awesome bard, weaving magical effects through the power of song, as in the whole reason why bards aren't the rubbish class they're stereotyped as. Can't put my finger on exactly why it doesn't feel like an extra item, but well done them anyway. With the extra focus on adventure, you'll find this plays differently to other games in the genre, especially recent titles. You'll wander about, solve a wee riddle or two, and talk to people a lot more than you'll be rubbing items together, what few there are to grab. There's arrows for scrolling your inventory, and the game barely needs them. I think I got one item over at most. Inventory will need to be given or combined at certain points, but it's not the main focus here. By exploring the Fairy Kingdom, you'll see things happen, encountering your fellow challengers and making absurdly polite conversation, usually, encountering talking turtles, pesky pixies, sexy spiders, even a gnome who has the world's smallest broomstick stuck up his arse. Sadly, the game utilises that stereotypical Scottish accent that bobs up and down towards ending in an upward inflection. Nowhere near as bad as the tutorial for Age of Empires 2, but points off nonetheless. Can't complain about the rest of the voice act, even the overly polite ones. They fit nicely with the type of do-gooder that would actually take part in a scavenger hunt created by the King of the Fairy People, and it's good to see an indie game that can afford a voice cast. That said, the money may have come out of the proofreading budget. Anyway, it's a good size of world you're in. Big enough to feel like you're exploring, but not so big that it's a chore to navigate. Unless it's the swamp, since it's technically a bloody maze, but at least you get a clue for that one. In fact, I feel like there was maybe a thing or two I missed due to how big the game seems to be, or from the holes in my achievement list, one of those. Before I go giving the wrong impression, however, I should point out that the narrative is still pretty linear. Puzzles and events pretty much go in a certain unwavering order. It's the way you go about solving the puzzles or triggering the events that's different. With the focus on adventure, I think they missed a trick here. We've already got games where you can solve a group of puzzles in any order. In fact, we've had them for quite a while. If they could transplant that design into a larger game area, I think that would work well. It might be a pain in the arse to weave into the narrative unless they simply went with the need three items to open gate type of thing and separated out the puzzles for each, but I think the feeling you'd get from that would be fantastic, or terrifying depending on how big they end up making the sequel, not to mention whether or not you actually get that kind of wanderlust. If you're looking for a game with a long, complex narrative that makes you solve some puzzles along the way, this might not be for you. You have to want to go explore everything and talk to everyone outside of the I have run out of things to do now, I try everything on everything else type of thing. And whilst I do like this game, and I appreciate it feeling different from much of its contemporaries, in a good way, this does feel like a setup for a sequel, especially the ending screen which tells you the story will continue in the sequel, kind of a giveaway that one. I'm also worried that the finished series will end up feeling like a game split in two. Well, even if it was, we didn't have to blow $3.3 million to find that out. So we've got a point-and-click game featuring a simple plot and emphasises adventure over puzzles, but has a low price point and hilariously low system requirements. I know I've said how simple the plot is numerous times, but it was enough to make me interested in the sequel, so that ain't nothing.